Blog Talk Radio.
There is one who is holy. There is one full of beauty. Only one who is worthy of praise. There is one who is faithful. There is one full of mercy. Only one who is worthy of praise. Jesus,
welcome to The Word Revealed. My name is Jackie Roberson, and I am your host of The Word Revealed, and I am glad to have you here with me tonight. I pray and hope that the Lord walked with you today and blessed you today and gave you what you need in the Spirit. You're here tonight. We are here tonight on The Word Revealed, and we are going to be talking about spiritual warfare. This is going on our third week. We are running an eight-week series every Monday night, 7 o'clock Central Time, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, and 5 o'clock if you live out on the West Coast. We're running an eight-week series on spiritual warfare. Week one, we started out talking about boot camp. Boot camp referred to the fact of when we first enter into the kingdom and how the Lord wants to transform us from our fleshly ways and our fleshly thoughts and bring us into the kingdom. Just like the Army, Navy, or Marines would do when someone joins the military branch. They are transformed from civilian thinking and civilian living into becoming a soldier and knowing what that means and knowing the rules and the regulations of that. And what they do is they really become servants to their country, to this nation, and they put their lives on the line serving us. And so it is in the kingdom of God. When you get saved, you enter into a place that's called boot camp, and you learn how to be transformed from the things of the flesh into the things of the Spirit. And that's what we kind of went over basically during week one. We kind of got more in depth of how we must live as soldiers in God's army. When people join the military branch, like I said, they are no longer civilians. You have to do away with the way you were raised and with the way you were thinking, and your mind and your body has to be transformed into a soldier. You have to think like a soldier. You have to react like a soldier. And whether you're on a battlefield or at the grocery store, you are still a soldier in one of these military branches, and you are to conduct yourself as such. So it is in the kingdom of God. Once we come into the kingdom, we belong to God, and we have been cleansed from our sins. The blood of Jesus has washed away our sins forever, not just washed our sins at the altar and then left us dirty in the kingdom. But once you are washed in the blood of Christ, that has been forgiven. Your sins have been totally remitted. Jesus paid the price for those sins. He took a whooping for those sins. So we are no longer in a sin nature. It does not mean that we are not capable of sinning, but that's what the blood is there for. The blood is there to cleanse us. The Holy Ghost convicts us of it. We repent, and our sins are washed away immediately. What we must understand about the blood of Christ is that it's for our past, present, and future. Without the blood of Christ, we would not have any future. So therefore, we must get rid of the idea that the only time we got washed in the blood was at the altar, and it washed away the sins that we repented about. But now that we are in the kingdom, we are still dirty. I want to ask you a question. If we are so wretched, if we are so filthy and dirty in God, can anyone tell me why would God bother to take his Holy Spirit, which is so holy, which is so clean, which is so righteous, and which is so powerful, and put it in a body that is full of dirt and sin? We must come into the realization that it's not by our might and it's not by our works, but it's strictly by the blood of Christ and what Christ has done for us at the cross. So this week, that's what we studied about the first week and the second week concerning spiritual warfare. This week we're going to talk a little about, it's called the combat zone. Once you become saved and filled with the Spirit of the Lord, Satan comes in immediately to ruin everything that God has predestined for you to do in the kingdom. What we have to realize is that we must be transformed. Our minds must be renewed daily. Every day that we wake up, the battlefield is no longer on the streets. When you look in the, if you go to the Old Testament and you look in the Old Testament, you will see where in the Old Testament the battlefield was physical. It was really about actual weapons such as arrows or rocks or slingshots or whatever they used, whether it was horses, whether it was swords. It was actual weapons. But what it was a foreshadowing of what we would have to conquer and overcome in our minds. The battlefield now is in the mind. Satan realized that attacking us physically only when he began to attack people in the Bible and persecution came forth. What persecution did was cause the kingdom of God to grow. So Satan decided to back off on persecuting and killing us, not saying that that's not still going on in the world today, because it is. What he wants to do in this time, in this area, is make the battlefield in our minds, because he knows if our minds are ever transformed, so is the soul. If the soul is ever transformed, then the Spirit of God has full reign in you to manifest himself through you mightily. So Satan wants to come in, and he wants the battlefield to be the battlefield of the mind. And the battlefield of the mind is a transitioning, and it's a process. It's not something that happens overnight. You have to realize that we were born into sin. We were born into this world. We were raised by our parents, and we have taken on many forms and fashions of this world. We have been taught by society. We have gone to school, we have been educated, and we have learned many things of the flesh, in the flesh, by the flesh. Those things have nothing to do with the kingdom of God. Once you are born into the kingdom of God, you become a spirit being. So democracy and the things of this world have nothing to do with actually transforming and taking place in the spirit. When we are talking about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, we are talking about a sovereign kingdom being ruled and reigned by God himself. There's a difference between a democratic society and a kingdom. And when you think about the kingdom of God, you cannot bring your diplomatic or your constitutional rights over into the kingdom of God, because a king, everything. When you're thinking about a kingdom there is, you can't vote God in and you can't vote him out. You cannot, or we cannot, come to God with our own opinions and expect God to be a servant unto what we think and how we feel. So when a transformation is taking place, we have to be transformed from a democratic society into a kingdom where God is totally sovereign, where God totally owns everything. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's in the book of Psalms, and the fullness thereof. So everything, God created everything in the earth. Satan has never had dominion of the earth. He has never had dominion over God's creation like it has been preached and taught by some religious authorities. God has never lost control of the earth that he has created, and he is still in control and always will be in control, whether that is due to your enemies, whether that is due to blessings, whether that is due to power, it doesn't matter. Whether that's due to your success, everything that happens in your life, God is in charge over. The Bible says that he reigns on the just and the unjust. So even the unjust, whether they're in a rich state, whether they're in an impoverished state, whether they're happy, whether they're sad, God is still in control. Always have been, always will be. Now, what I really want to get into tonight is about combat in the spirit. And what I'd like to ask you and get your attention about is, do you know what your weapons of warfare are? We are taught by Paul that our weapons of warfare are not carnal, but mighty through the pulling down of strongholds. So now, if our weapons of warfare are not carnal, what are our weapons? I know that many people think of prayer as a weapon, and it can be used and applied as such, but it's also our communication and our relationship with God. Prayer is about communicating with the Father. Prayer is about communicating with the Son. Prayer is also about the Holy Ghost communicating with the Father and the Son that the Father's perfect will and his divine will without mistake and error can be prayed for us by the Holy Ghost through us, so that the divine will of God and the perfect will of God can be downloaded in our minds, in our hearts, and in our body, and that we can act upon what the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, whichever you want to call him, will quicken in our flesh to do. Jesus said that I will not leave you comfortless, but I will send you back the Comforter. And he will teach you all things. And he says, whatsoever the Father has spoken, the Holy Ghost will reveal it unto you. So the Holy Spirit being in our body is about him having the ability to pray for us, because we don't know what to pray for as we ought. So prayer is also a communication device for us in the kingdom. It is a kingdom language. It's not just a fact of speaking in tongues so that we can validate that we have received the gift of the Holy Ghost, but it is a vocal utterance that God has given us through the Holy Ghost that we may speak unto God in the mystery, so that Satan does not know what the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are talking about. And so that to a certain extent, we don't, unless it's quickened to us, unless God gives us an understanding of that. Now, when you think about combat and you think about weapons, there can be many weapons. There are many aspects of combat. There's different types of combat. When you think about our natural military, you have the Air Force. The Air Force fights from the air. They can they have airplanes that can bomb and shoot missiles and target areas and pinpoint areas so that they can be totally destroyed. So you got your Air Force, and they protect the air, or they will assault the air in which the enemy is attacking. They will go in the air to attack the enemy in his own realm, in his own country, in his own nation, so to speak. When you think about warfare, you also got to think about the Navy. The Navy attacks and defends the seas. When you think about the Army is a ground troop. They protect the ground. Now, when you think about warfare in the kingdom of God, you got to also ask yourself, are your weapons for the air? Are your weapons for the ground troops? Or is your weapon in the sea? Now, to people that don't understand military protocol or military concept and how the military operates, this may sound very strange, but if you just bear with me, the Lord has given me some examples in the scripture, and we will go to scripture and confirm exactly what the Lord is speaking about tonight. Now, when you talk about warfare in the air, Paul teaches us and he tells us about the different spirits that are in the air. He talks about the principalities and the powers of darkness. And when Paul is talking about this, he is not just talking about one devil. We know that Satan is the ruler of his dark kingdom. But when Paul is talking about principalities and powers of darkness, these powers of darkness and principalities operate on a totally different basis, doing totally different things. But if you don't know if you're fighting principalities or spiritual wickedness in high places or powers and powers of darkness, how can you know how to respond to the attack? If we don't know what it is we're fighting, if we don't know exactly what spirits in Satan's kingdom are attacking us, then how can we possibly know what weapons to use? In God's kingdom, there is a protocol order. You have the Father, you have the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The Bible tells us that we shall march and not break our ranks. Just as there are different rankings in the military, you have generals, you have lieutenant generals, you have majors, you have captains, you have lieutenants. Those are all different rankings. And when God is telling us that we shall march and not break our ranks, you must know what your rank and power is in warfare. If you do not know your rank nor your power, then you will not possibly know the spiritual attack that is coming against you. I say that for this very reason. I'll give you an example. When Paul went to the Gentile nations, he had to go out on boats and ships in order to reach places that was distant from Jerusalem. Paul went to Antioch and in Philippi and different places such as this. When Paul sailed on these missions, Paul tells us in the scriptures how he was shipwrecked several times. The reason why Paul was shipwrecked is because of the winds and the rains and the raging of the seas. Now, you have to stop and ask yourself, why did Paul face so many shipwrecks? Do you really think that was a coincidence? No, it wasn't. It was not a coincidence for the simple fact that Paul's warfare was in the air. Paul was an apostle, which is a high-ranking authority in the kingdom. And because Paul was not only an apostle, but the chief apostle, and God ordained him to be so. No one elected him to. There was no deacons to vote him in. There were no deacons to vote him out. God himself chose Paul, just like God himself chooses us. Jesus said, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you." We cannot decide who we think we are going to be in the kingdom of God. It does not work that way. It never has worked that way. It never will work that way. So we cannot wake up one morning and decide that we're going to go to school and we're going to learn theology and now we're going to become a pastor. We cannot decide that we're going to become a prophet. We cannot decide that we're going to become a teacher or an evangelist or an apostle. We cannot decide those things because we don't have any power to have the gifts, the anointing, or the vision, or the insight to know what the future holds. We do not have the ability to pick and choose those fields because they have to be predestined and ordained by God from your mother's womb. And so Paul was chosen by God, and because Paul was highly chosen and Paul had the office, Paul had the power, he had the legislation, he had the whole kingdom of God backing and supporting him because that's what God called him to do. And when Paul went on missionary missions, Paul faced the principalities of the air. Now, if you think that the principalities, which are the demonic princes in Satan's kingdom, cannot stir up the water or the winds in the waves of the oceans and cause turbulence as far as the air is concerned, then you haven't been reading your Bible correctly or you don't know very much about Scripture. All through the Bible, God has shown us that Satan is an imitator. Satan is not a creator nor an originator of anything. The only thing that he is original about is being a liar, a thief, and a devil. God says that he was a liar in the beginning and he is still a liar. God says that he is a deceiver and he still deceives. That is the only thing that Satan is truthful in is what God called him to be. And he was a devil in the beginning, and he is still a devil. But he does not create. God is a creator. Satan is an imitator. He mimics everything God does, or he tries to make mockery of what the Lord has done. So, because the Lord is the ruler of the earth, and Jesus had the power to say, "Peace be still." Now I want to ask you a question. If the winds and the seas were controlled by Jesus during the time that he sent Peter and the rest of the disciples across on the other side where this man was demonically possessed, and this man was in chains and he cut himself. And the Bible talks about how this man cut himself. And Jesus sent the multitudes away and he sent the disciples on the other side. And the Bible says how Jesus began to walk upon the water, coming to Peter and the rest of them while they were on the water. Now, during this time that the Lord was walking to them upon the water, the winds and the seas were tumultuous. So now if Jesus was controlling that aspect of the seas and the winds at that particular time, then why would he turn around and rebuke the winds and say, "Peace be still," if that was not demonic? The Lord says that if Satan's kingdom fight against itself, then his kingdom cannot stand. So it is in the kingdom of God. If Jesus is going to create a situation and then turn around and rebuke his own self, how can his kingdom possibly stand. So when you think about tumultuous weather, it can be done or activated through demonic forces, principalities of the air. Principalities hover over countries. Principalities hover over nations. Let's take a look at Goliath, for instance. Goliath was a principality. The reason why Goliath was a principality, because all of Israel was in fear of Goliath. Goliath had the whole army of Israel at a standstill. And here comes David as a boy, and he challenges Goliath with only a slingshot and some five smooth stones. At the time that David challenged Goliath, they tried to put Saul's armor on David. But David could not defend Israel, and David could not defeat Goliath in Saul's armor. I'm here tonight to tell you that you cannot do spiritual warfare with someone else's anointing. You cannot do spiritual warfare trying to stand in somebody else's shoes. You cannot do spiritual warfare trying to repeat what you've heard your pastor or some other bishop or some teacher or anybody else tell you that you need to say seven times and the devil will disappear. You need to be led by the Spirit. Only God can reveal to you who you are in the Spirit, by His Spirit, through one of the fivefold offices. We cannot choose and elect who we want to be. When it comes to spiritual warfare, you must know what your weapons are, and you must know what enemy you are encountering. Now, there's a difference when you're in warfare. There is a difference between warfare and spirits of torment. And a lot of people get warfare and the spirits of torment mixed up. When you talk about spiritual warfare, Paul taught us that in spiritual warfare, Satan throws fiery darts. Now, there are three elements in which warfare strategy, which Satan will come at you with. The first thing that Satan will always come at you with when you are in warfare is temptation. Anytime he is tempting you to do wrong, you are in warfare. When Jesus was baptized in the river of Jordan, and he came up out of the water, immediately the Bible says that the heavens was open and the Spirit of God descended down upon him like a dove. What you also must realize in warfare is that if you have the word but you don't have a spirit, you are powerless. If you have the Spirit, but you don't have the Word, you are powerless. Jesus was the Word made flesh. From the time Jesus was born in the manger until he became an adult man and he was baptized in the river of Jordan, you hear absolutely nothing about Jesus fighting any devils, and you hear absolutely nothing about Jesus doing or performing any miracles, because he was the Word made flesh. Now, when he was baptized in the river of Jordan and the Spirit came, descended upon him, then you had the Spirit and the Word coming together. Once the Spirit and the Word comes together in you, the first thing Satan will do is tempt you. That's how you discern and know when you have become one with God, because here comes temptation. When Jesus was, when the Word, which was Christ, and the Spirit were became one, the first thing the devil, the Spirit did was drove him out in the wilderness, and he was tempted of the devil for 40 days and for 40 nights. And if you will notice, Jesus' temptation was about fleshly things and demonstrating his power in the Spirit. Satan told him that if he was the Son of God, he could turn the stones into bread. tempting him with food, knowing that Jesus was on a fast. So he was tempting Jesus to break his fast. And the weapon that Jesus used against him was the word. Everything that Satan tempted him in, Jesus didn't come back with his own opinion. He didn't come back with what he thought, but he used the word. And when Satan tried to tempt him to turn the stone into bread, Jesus came back with a scripture and said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." Every word. So Jesus resisted him through the word. Jesus resisted him by the word. If we are spirit being, speaking unto devils in the flesh is not a weapon. It is an act of ignorance, and Satan knows by that act that we don't know who we are, and he comes in with spirits of torments after he has tempted us and we have failed the test. Anytime we are tempted by Satan, we must stand on God's word. God's word is your greatest weapon. Without that, Jesus said, it's like a man building his house upon sands. And when the winds blow, principalities, and the floods come, because Satan will come in and get you like a flood, and when the rain descends, persecution, trouble, and beat up on your house, great will be the fall of your house if it's built upon sand. But if it's built upon a rock, and we all know that Jesus is a rock. So when Satan comes in against us with temptation, we must stand on the rock, not what we think, only upon God's word. That's how you know when you're in spiritual warfare, temptation will come. Temptation is the first thing you'll be tempted with. Jesus said that we cannot be greater than him. He said we can be as our Lord, but we can't be greater. And everything that Jesus went through was an example showing us what we must do also. If you will remember, I just said that Satan is not a creator. All he does is mimic. He does the same thing over and over and over again because there is no creation in him. So all he knows to do is come at us with temptation. It's the first thing that he'll attack us with. The second thing is accusations. Now, when I'm talking about accusations, the Bible says that he is the accuser of the brothers. What he will do is he will come and accuse you of the things that you did and badger you about your past. He will badger you about what you didn't do. He will badger you about your lost opportunities. He will badger you about promises you didn't keep. He will badger you about things that you lost. And what he is doing is accusing you to get you to accuse yourself. But the Bible tells us that there is therefore, in Romans 8, that there is now meaning right this minute, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And Satan comes in against our mind with accusations against our own self. And not only will he come in with accusations against you, towards you, but he will cause others to come in and accuse you of things that you did wrong, that you shouldn't have did, that you ought to did. Those are accusations. If the Holy Ghost is not convicting you any wrongdoing in your flesh, and last week we talked about the difference between condemnation and conviction. The difference in condemnation is that's just what it will do. Jesus, the Holy Ghost, the Father, the Son, whatever you want to call him, will not condemn you. He will come in and convict you so that he can heal you of the very thing that he has convicted you of. In other words, he will bring that up to deliver you from it. He will not bring it up to beat you down with it. That's the difference in conviction and condemnation. Condemnation beats you down. Conviction brings it up out of your mind, brings it up out of your heart, brings that wrong thing up to the surface so God can heal you and deliver you from it through the blood of Jesus. And bring forth a sorrow in you that brings forth a repentance. And once you repent, it is never thought of anymore by God. That's the difference in condemnation and conviction. Satan comes in to condemn. The Holy Ghost is in us to convict. And once we have been convicted and say, oh my God, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. You are washed by the washing of the water of the word, and you are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. I want to ask you, what devil in hell can reach his hand in the blood and snatch what God has cleansed you from out of it? We're giving the enemy way too much power from the pulpits and everywhere else concerning, quote-unquote, our sin issues. And so the difference in knowing conviction from condemnation is if God brings it up, he brings it up to bless you. He brings it up to bring it up out of you. And when he brings it up out of you and he washes it by his blood and he heals you from it and he delivers you from it, he comes in that place and he resides. Tell me what demon can come in and kick him out. The only way Satan can come back in with seven more spirits more wicked than himself is when we allow what he accuses us of and we begin to agree with it. Agreement is very powerful, even if we are agreeing with the devil. Satan knows how powerful agreement is. So when he comes in and he calls us failures, when he comes in and he calls us everything but a child of God, and we agree with that, that's what gives him power to begin to take us into torment. Now, temptation shows you that you're in warfare. Accusation shows you in warfare, and deception is what he also uses in warfare. When he decided to talk to Eve, he deceived Eve by telling her that if she would eat of the fruit, that she would not die. That God was lying when he told Adam that the day that he eat of the tree, that they would surely die. Satan came along in the book of Genesis and convinced her that if she would eat of the fruit, that she would not die, but that she would be as God, knowing good and evil. When her and Adam were already created in the express image of God, they were good. The Bible talks about how everything God made, he saw was good. He never, ever said it was perfect. When you go in the book of Genesis, everything God created, it says, and God saw that it was good. He never, ever said it was perfect. But Adam and Eve were created in his image. They had his spirit. And Satan convinced them that they didn't have his spirit by telling them that they would be like gods, knowing good and evil. I want to ask you tonight, how many times has Satan came and deceived you and told you that God wasn't in you? How many times has he convinced us that we are so dirty, filthy, and unclean that God could never, ever reside in our flesh? How many times have Satan told us that we have done so wrong so many times, so often, and we have been so sinful that God could never use us or possibly love us? But yet, the Holy Ghost is dwelling in our flesh. Now, either the fact of the Holy Ghost dwelling in our flesh is lying, or what we are hearing is lying. I choose to believe what I'm hearing is lying, because God is not a liar. So now, if God has not convicted you of a specific thing, why are we letting everything and everybody else accuse us of who or who we not? Why are we listening to every other voice but God's? You mean to tell me God is not God enough to address an issue with you himself? But yet God will come through someone else and make you feel like you're nothing? Does that really sound like that is God's personality? And even if God does chasten you, he does it in love. He does not do it in hate and bitterness. So the way to know that you are in warfare is to know this. Satan's going to come at you three ways: through temptation, through accusation, and through deception. Now, if he comes at you and you are in torment, you have just became a POW. When you are in the military and you are captured by the enemy, you are bound, gagged, tied, and then you are interrogated and tortured, tormented to give up the secrets that the enemy is trying to get out of you as a United States soldier, regardless to what branch you're in. So now, if you are being tormented, you have been held captive, and you are now a prisoner of war. Warfare, Satan will throw fiery darts. Your fiery darts are temptation. Your fiery darts are accusation. Your fiery darts are deception. But when you start being tormented, he torments you not to forgive you for your sins. Christ has forgiven you, but you have not forgiven yourself. And you can tell when unforgiveness of your own wrongdoing is there, is because Satan can come in and cause you to dwell in it, live in it, and be tormented in it. Our unforgiveness of our own selves has made us prisoners of war. If you're being tormented by what you did several years ago, you are being tormented. If you are being held captive in your mind about what you should have did 3 days ago, you are being tormented. How can we possibly forgive our brother 70 times 7 in one day when we can't even forgive our own self? How can God possibly reveal to us the power that is lying dormant in our flesh when we can't see past our weaknesses, our wrongs, our faults, and our shortcomings. Those things are spirits of torment. Keeping our minds occupied in the spirit of unforgiveness, so that the weapon and the captivity of being a POW can reside in the place where the power and the weapons of God are supposed to be residing. Christ said that he cannot put new wine in old bottles. He cannot put fresh revelation in us with old condemnation, with accusation, and with spirits of torment. He said, the book, it says in James that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways, not some of them. So if I have the mind of Christ today, but I am thinking about what I could have accomplished last year and I missed the mark and I am beating myself up about it, everything I set my hand to and do ain't going to have any stability in it. I am unstable in everything I set my hand to do. Because one day I'm a child of God, one day I'm so wretched and miserable, till how could God possibly love me? How could God possibly want to use someone as filthy, unclean, and wretched as me? How could God even want to walk with someone as terrible as I am in the cool of the day? What good is his word when I am living in unforgiveness for my own self? When God was giving me and revealing these things to me this week, he told me that the greatest deliverance that the body of Christ needs is forgiveness of them own selves. We are prejudiced and we are racist. We are biased and we are unforgiving toward our own selves. We limit what we can do. We don't believe that we can do all things through Christ which strengthens us, because we think we are so weak, insignificant, and so sinful that God could never use us in that capacity. Because why? We are POWs in a war that we should be more than conquerors in. Because we don't recognize the difference in conviction and condemnation. We don't recognize the difference in warfare and being a prisoner of war. I want you to stop and really examine everything that God has ever told you and see if it doesn't outweigh the condemning facts of Satan. Satan has told you that nobody will ever hear you, that you'll never have a ministry, that your ministry will never get anywhere. He has told you you ain't got no money, you can't bless nobody, you ain't got no house, you can't house nobody, you ain't got no car, you can't go nowhere, you ain't got this, you ain't got that. It's always about what we don't have. When Jesus said that he would supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. It is also written in Psalms that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. And when you look that up in the Hebrew, it means I shall not lack. So why are we listening to how much we don't have instead of listening to the voice that's telling us we got it all? Why are we listening to a devil that wants to keep us bound, tied, gagged, and tormented in his concentration camp so that we can never win the souls and walk this earth and testify about the goodness of the Lord? Paul said, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So just know, when you get into arguments with your family members, stop and think about what you're really arguing about, because it looks like it's a fleshly thing, and it just looks like it's your son or daughter or your mother or your auntie or your uncle, whoever it is. But if we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, what is the argument about? Where did the argument stem from, and who started it? What's really the root cause of that argument? What is really the root cause of the misunderstanding? God is not the author of confusion. So if he's not the author of confusion, where is it stemming from? We are spirit beings, and the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, and we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Taught us we wrestle against principalities, spiritual wickedness in high places, and the powers of darkness. We need to wake up and realize that the war is not with the person down the street, that the war is not because my mama don't believe me. The war is not about my sister don't receive me. The war is not about my son is disrespectful. The war is not about nobody sees my ministry. The war is not about flesh or our bloodline. The war is about the blood of Jesus, the transfusion that we have received in the Spirit, and the new family that we have been born into, where we have new brothers and sisters and family in Christ. Let's realize that the kingdom of God is within us. If the whole kingdom of God resides in us, how can we possibly be prisoners of war? The Bible teaches us that the kingdom of God is within you. If Christ, the hope of glory, truly lives in our flesh, and he said that he is the truth, the way, and the life, why are we living a life that Christ died to redeem us from? What is the point of salvation if we are just as tormented as the sinner? Just as confused as the sinner. Just as powerless as the sinner. Just as wretched, sinful, and full of darkness as the sinner. What is the point of salvation if we don't have any light? What is the point of the Holy Ghost living in our flesh if we have no salvation? If redemption has not already come, if we have not been redeemed, what is the purpose of picking up the word and reading it, walking in it, and live in it. If it's of none effect, if it has no power, and if everything that we are living and saying and believing comes from the very enemy that Christ has delivered us from. Since when does Jesus partial deliver? Since when does he haphazardly deliver? When Jesus healed the woman with the issue of blood, he just didn't dry up her physical issue. Let me tell you something. Women in the Bible, without a man in the house, they had nowhere to survive. Women didn't hold down jobs in the Bible. If there was no man in the house to take care of that woman, she had no livelihood. So the woman with the issue of blood, how did she live? Where did she live? She was considered unclean. Not only did she have an issue that smelled horrible, not only did she have an issue that had to keep her body weak, the Bible says the life is in the blood, so if you're losing blood, life is oozing out of you. So she had to be physically weak. She couldn't go to the temple to worship, to pray, to give God an offering. She was considered unclean. And even if she had been given a job as a housemaid or anything of the such, who's going to hire her because she was unclean? To be in her presence, to touch her, to have anything to do with her, would have caused you to be unclean. So when Jesus dried up her physical issue, he restored her back so that now she could have a husband, now she could go to the temple and worship, now she could go in the marketplace. He totally restored her whole entire life. Jesus will not deliver you in one area and leave you bound in another. When real deliverance comes, you are healed from your head to your toe. Your mind, your body, your soul, and your outward life is totally restored. Every person that I look at in the scriptures, the 10 lepers, he restored them back to society. He just didn't restore and clean their bodies. They were totally restored. Now they could go to the temple and give an offering and worship and get a job. They didn't have to beg anymore. Why do you think there were so many beggars in the Bible? I'm here to tell you that Jesus loves you. I don't care what anybody say. And I pray that this segment tonight has blessed you and has opened up your eyes and opened up your understanding that Jesus is alive and well and so in his blood. May the Lord continue to bless you until next Monday night at 7 o'clock. We will see you again next week. May the Lord continue to bless you and keep you. In Jesus' name is my prayer.
There is one who is holy. There is one full of beauty. Only one.